Hello and welcome to yet another episode of Tysharam and Ethryn, a Wheel of Time podcast. I'm Will.
I'm Sam.
Today we are continuing on in The Great Hunt. Before we get started, I just want to remind you that, hey, it does cost us a little money to make this podcast, and you can always donate by visiting tsmpodcast.com and clicking on that donate button on our website. You know, if you're not into it, it's cool. We want you here anyway, and enjoy this podcast, which Sam will be handling the main narrative for. So I believe we're on chapter 11. Take it away.
Chapter 11, Glimmers of the Pattern. Kick things off with a Rand perspective. Everybody's pretty messed up from that bubble in the pattern or fever dream or whatever it was we were just talking about at the end of the last episode. Dream sequence thingy. Ingtar calls for a stop even though it's still light out. Rand wonders if what he saw in the village means he's going mad. Sweet summer child, you ain't seen nothing yet. Beginning to realize there's a sizable group pursuing them, Rand asks Ingtar, what happened in that village? Trollocs took them, same at the ferry, but doesn't really know what was up with that fade that was staked through the heart, though. Harder to explain that. Trollocs definitely ate all the people, that much we know. Charming lot, Trollocs. happens a lot near the Blight, apparently. Fades do worse stuff, apparently.
Except for that one Trolloc who's on, like, a fully vegan...
Oh, yeah, right. He just eats, he, like, eats their whole garden, I guess.
Right.
Kills them, but... And,
but he's even more frustrating. Like, you really, you just like, dude, we don't want to hear about how you don't eat people.
Right. Yeah, I'd rather you actually eat me than talk to me about how you're not going to eat me. Yeah,
yeah,
for sure.
He's just like, look, I don't eat people, so you don't have to worry about it because I, you know, I'm gluten-free, just all
tofu,
organic.
Only tofu.
Yeah.
Impossible people, maybe, but only, you know, only on occasion.
Impossible people. That's hilarious. It tastes just like people.
Just made in a vat instead. So fades apparently do worse stuff than eat people. No one says exactly what, but, you know, we can guess. We don't need that to be spelled out. They're fun.
Ingtar, they teach them geometry.
Got to learn where the knives and forks go on the table in a formal meal. The salt cellar, exactly,
yeah,
where
that,
that's placed.
See, that's the kind of thing that they do.
Ingtar hands Rand a bundle, says Moraine told him to give it over. Also, if anything happens to Ingtar, the lances will follow Rand. Me, the protagonist gasps. So Neal Stephenson's book, Snow Crash, stars hero protagonists. Only that dude could get away with naming a character something like hero protagonist, I swear.
Well, and works. Also apparently Christopher Nolan, because the main character in Tenet is the protagonist.
Yeah, true say. Touche. Forgot about that. I guess it's kind of like Stephen King writing himself as a character in the Dark Tower books. Not something I could pull off personally. Yeah. Anyway, but I'm just a sheep herder over here. Get used to it, buddy. you know, in some ways I prefer the woolhead kind of shtick to later versions of Rand. Rand protests that he doesn't want to be second in command. Ingtar says, you will do your duty and peace favor your sword is the answer he gets. I'm going to say that the next time I have to tell someone something. That request goes to business intelligence. Peace favor your sword, Chad. Rand sneaks off into the trees to open the bundle. Well, I guess he sneaks. I mean, no one seems to care. Oops, dragon banner. Double oops. Someone did notice Rand sneak off. Perrin and Matt show up just in time to see it. Matt's still kind of acting mean drunk thanks to the dagger withdrawal. Says, well, now he's got a banner. We'll hear no end of lording. Rand says, I will not be an Aes Sedai puppet. Then Perrin asks Rand if he can channel. Double oops. Rand admits it. And Matt starts babbling curses. Shut up, Matt. Perrin's words, not mine. but yeah, you know, Matt says they should run away. Perrin agrees, but says Rand might not be able to run. He's also talking about Perrin's wolf thing. even though he doesn't say that. Rand thinks about it and decides, you know, stick around if only to spite Moraine, who he thinks maybe gave it to him to make him run for some reason. So back in the camp, Loyal is looking at a stone column buried in the ground. Says the markings on it look familiar. Rayan goes to sleep holding onto the void.
And as playwright Anton Chekhov said, if you have a
stone column.
Yes, stone column
buried in the ground. Then you better have a dream sequence about it that results in someone going to anyway. Swapped everybody's favorite put on Fane. He was a dark friend once before Bilesman put him on his path chasing the three Tavirin. Shadow Logoth changed him, of course, we know. He's got Matt's dagger and is acting kind of like a possessed crack addict, which is par for the course for him, really. That's pretty much his thing now. He's got 12 dark friends, 20 Trollocs with him. Oh, yeah. And Fane was the one who staked that mirror draw back in the village, orders the Trollocs to kill the remaining villagers that they have prisoner, and wonders how to open the chest he has, but hasn't been able to figure it out. So he puts the dagger on it, top of the chest, so that no one will get into it. Nobody touching that dagger because they saw what it did to the mirror draw. Suddenly, he can't sense Rand like he could before, but he thinks Rand will come to him this time rather than him having to follow Rand. The dance has not even begun yet. We'll dance on Toman Head and I'll be free of you. I'll see you dead at last. So on to chapter 12, woven in the pattern.
I just pictured Fane doing a little
dance,
calypso dance. Yeah.
Doing the Macarena, I think.
There you go.
That'd be great. Chapter 12, woven in the pattern. It's an Egwene perspective. She and Nynaeve go to the Amarlin's palanquin. So if anyone else wasn't 100% sure what a palanquin looks like, it's one of those box chair thingies carried by four dudes. In this case, though, carried by horses. I mean, that does not sound or look safe. I mean, I'll pass. Y'all need like a carriage or something. I guess this is better if you don't have a road, maybe. But you figure a horse-drawn carriage wouldn't do well in tundra or sod. So maybe a palanquin is like an off-road carriage. Four-wheel drive or eight-hoof drive. So I was looking this up, though, on Wikipedia under other foot power. I noticed something called a dandy horse. So definitely Google that.
I feel like I shouldn't, though.
No, it's okay. I hear you, but dandy horse. It's quite funny looking. Like, it's just a very, very strange. Sort of looks like a precursor to a bike that's just mainly a joke. It's like a bike, but you still have to walk. But I do feel like that could catch on today in like IKEA, maybe, you know, maybe for golfing without a golf cart. Anyway, Egwene learns that a bow sniper tried to kill the Amarlin, but was thankfully unsuccessful. Swan being Swan, she's like, man, I'm good. Let's hit the road. Agilmar says, whoa, 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 whoa. Somebody tried to off you, my city lady. We got to figure out why. I said, off you, my city lady. I meant to say in my city lady, but I think I prefer my city lady. Can't tell a little Swan nothing. She says, nah, notices Egwene and Nynaeve. Moraine says, these are our two new novices who were born with a spark. The Amarlin makes Egwene nervous and with good reason. So as they leave, the Shine Orange cheer, probably as much, thank God you're leaving, as yay, Aes Sedai. Nynaeve says, don't worry about your Rand. He's got Ingtar and a boy's guarding his back. You know, I'm paraphrasing a little, but basically that's what she says. A little travel montage. The Ajahs are all pitch and
You keep going.
Pitched in separate tents. And Swan and Liana have one each, too. Lan checks in on Nynaeve one night. And Egwene can't hear the exchange, but she sees Nynaeve bite his head off, literally. Egwene notices him standing outside her tent for a long time in the dark before he leaves. Egwene notices Lan standing outside Nynaeve's tent for a long time in the dark before he finally leaves. So Nynaeve will probably get a real doozy of an email later. Rain doesn't really have much to do with them now that they're officially novices, so other people will help them. One night, Varen stops in for a visit. She tells Egwene that channeling could be dangerous before she learns what she's doing. Both girls admit that they have channeled before, although Nynaeve is not happy about it. Varen says she's lucky to be alive, that only one in four women who start channeling on their own survive. Wilders, they're called in the White Tower. I feel like she just made up the statistic, but you know.
Yeah, that does. But it's Varen.
Yeah, like, right. Well, so maybe it's true.
It's true. You know, I was just thinking about it, and like Wilders so sounds like it would be the title of a spinoff show.
Right. Wilders, the Coven. I don't know.
Yeah.
There you go. Starring Joey from Friends. Not even Egwene tried the flower bud trick, which is very different from Rand's flame and void business. You are the bud. There is no spoon or whatever. Egwene feels a trickle, but that's it. Nynaeve can't really feel anything, and she feels more like a blackthorn bush than a rosebud. Just I can sympathize with that feeling sometimes. So to motivate her, Varen says, if you want to be a novice, you get to do a lot of fun chores. So in response to that, Nynaeve sets some blankets on fire by accident. Varen puts the fire out and says, okay, that's enough for one day. Nynaeve says, I was angry and fire popped into my head. So Varen says, you can burn yourselves out by channeling too much. So then Alviarin, Alana. This is where I said, this must be where I was thinking Alviarin. I mentioned Alviarin last episode. Anyway, so she was probably in the background at some point.
She would have been with that entourage.
In the retinue, indeed. Mm-hmm. Alviarin, Alana, Leandrin stop by, ostensibly to train the ladies, but really they want to question them about the Tavirian boys. Or in Alana's case, to generally talk about men. Dream montage. Is this the first one for Egwene? Probably not. They all blur together. Dreams of Rand.
Dream montage. Dream montage. Dream montage.
Dreams of Rand, other stuff. Finally, the Amyrlin's entourage reaches Meadow, where they get on a boat to Tar Valon. Moraine and Lan have already left, as have Leandrin and Varen. Egwene tells Anaya about her dreams. Dude with fire eyes, yada, yada, yada. Rand in trouble. Anaya says, oh, you might be a dreamer with a capital D, which is like foretelling. Or you could have eaten some bad pickles and had funky dreams. Probably the pickle thing, but, you know, we'll keep an eye on it. They board the River Queen and are off. Now I want a chicken finger basket from DQ. They do, you know, like a lunch deal that includes chicken, white gravy, fries, drink, and a small ice cream. It's like 7,000 calories, give or take. Worth every penny. Worth every calorie. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Yes, 7,000. Yeah, you know, I remember when I was really into calorie counting for like 5 minutes, and like a medium fry from Chick-fil-A was like 400 or 600 calories. It's like, no, no, don't take that away from me.
Right. Yeah, I did calorie counting for a couple of years.
It and works, lost but a, it's a great way to like hate your life. It's just like, it was so stressful. Like, it works. Right. It definitely works. But it's like, every time I sit down to eat, I'm like feeling guilty. Like, I don't have many calories left.
Also, it's really hard not to become that guy that's like
always, you know, saying that, the number of calories in everything.
You know, that's like 350 calories just in that one thing.
Indeed.
Right?
Yeah. I would rather, I much prefer my current approach, which is destroying all my joints, but it's like go out and run 10 miles and then eat everything, all the unhealthy things, and knowing that it's not doing any favors for my heart, but I'm not putting on any weight. So as long as my knees hold out, which might not be much longer.
My approach is to neither really care about the exercise or the diet right now. So
I think I'm headed back down that path. I'm definitely on that. I'm opening that door. Yeah. Chapter 13, From Stone to Stone. Oh, hey, cool. Another world. Can't wait to see this stuff in this show. That'll be fun. Glad this mini worlds dealio happened so early. You know, we're definitely going to have to address this. I mean, this will be, I mean, you could almost see them cutting it out, but they better not, you know, it's kind of my feeling on it. Like, you can make an argument that it's not strictly necessary, maybe.
Right.
Like, you could have these conversations happen in the normal world, but come on, man. If nothing else, we're just talking about like an Instagram filter here, you know?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. That's a good way of putting it. Yeah. You can totally picture
just not them much all sense in to it.
Sepia tone, you know?
Right. And, because that's like, we keep hearing that described, like everything is just lacking color, and like,
right,
Rand says that.
Yeah, why does everything feel like it's in the old west right now?
right,
you know, these chapters remind me a lot of The Magician's Nephew.
Yeah, sure.
How in that book, which was not the first book written, but was the first book chronologically in the Chronicles of Narnia.
It's like how in it you end up seeing how Narnia was created as one of the many worlds.
Yeah, and so they, you know, they visit like a few different worlds, and one of them's like a dying world, and then they go from there to
it's
Narnia.
It's cool how the White Witch is from that dying world. Like, she's not even from Narnia. It's interesting.
Right. Yeah, good. So it kind of reminds me of that, like this idea of kind of multiple worlds that are accessible.
Right. Yeah. But, like there's always, like the woods or something, portal stones in this case. Yeah. I'm always a sucker for that. I mean, I think one example of where that's done well is The Magicians, not the sci-fi show, which is an atrocity, but the novels, which are quite whiny at times, but also great world building. And yeah, the mini worlds thing, theirs is like a bunch of fountains instead, which is fun. Yeah, that's, I'm always here for that sort of thing. I feel like we're headed into that with the MCU, and I'm definitely right. All about it. I think it'll be fun. And possibly the DC universe. I think I saw a picture from the Flash movie. It was like the Michael Keaton Batman symbol with blood on it. So it's like, we're kind of, it might just be timey-wimey stuff, but with the Flashpoint. But yeah, if we have a Michael Keaton Batman show up with a Ben Affleck Batman, like I'll watch that movie. Definitely. Oh, yeah. Definitely. Yeah. I'll watch that movie.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to watch pretty much anything DC that comes out, even if it's directed by like Yul Bull. I don't care how bad it is.
Oh, yeah.
Because I'll check it out and be like, wow, that was awful. But
right.
You know, at least I'm informed.
Exactly. I'm part of the conversation about how awful it is. So Rand wakes up and everyone is missing except Huron and Loyal. The remains of a column that he'd fallen asleep next to have been replaced by a giant full size column. So not in Toto anymore. Kansas, Toto, Indiana, that is.
Did you Google towns named Toto?
There's one in like Nigeria also, but I stuck with Indiana. I don't know.
Yeah, no, that sounds that's much, much better.
There is a Toto, Indiana.
Now I want to sing Africa by Toto.
Right. Oh man. Yeah. This is nice. Nice kind of roundabout there.
Yeah.
So steps go up to the cylinder above our blackened trees as if a firestorm had roared through them. Everything seems paler and subdued as if seen through mist. So Rand wakes Huron and Loyal up, and Loyal says, "Is it morning already?" Rand says, "It feels like a dream, and maybe it is one." In these books, that's as plausible as any other theory for their chief. So even if it's totally wrong in this particular case, Loyal realizes that the stone is an object of power used to transport people. He saw a picture of one in a book once. Underneath it said, "From stone to stone run the lines of if between the worlds that might be." He says the Aes Sedai in the Age of Legends could use it to journey to other worlds, but of course we don't have any Aes Sedai to channel, so no way that could be it. Nope. Rand realizes his goof. He went to sleep in the void, so he must have channeled in his sleep. Gotta hate it when that happens.
I mean, really, this is the first time that Rand realizes that the void is where he accesses the power.
Oh yeah.
It's kind of as a result of this.
Right. So Rand says he doesn't understand. Loyal waxes eloquent about quantum physics. If a woman goes left or right, does time's flow divide? Does the wheel then weave two patterns?
Is this quantum physics or metaphysics?
A little bit of both. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Quantum physics with the spooky action at a distance with quarks and all that stuff. Yeah, it's all intertwined for sure. There's supposedly many such stones around the world. Huron says, "Please get us home, Lord Rand." Rand starts to say, "What do you think I could do?" And then realizes he was indeed the one who got them into this mess in the first place. So instead he says, "I'll do my best. Shepherd's honor." Huron bows and says, "Honor to serve my lord." Rand is not used to this, of course, yet. So Rand tries to see Sidene, fails miserably. I guess a big part of it is he has no idea what he's doing, only feels the taint. Is the taste taint worse here too? Or is he just terrible at this?
Quit feeling the taint, man.
Yeah, especially not in public. Little column A, little column B. The void shattered into 1,000 razor shards, slicing his mind. Is my brain bleeding? I guess it's all right. Ouch, though. The others realize he's having some trouble, and he says, "Just give me a minute and I'll try again. I need some Gatorade." Huron says, "What if we track Dark Flint instead? I can smell the trail." So he points to the rim of the hollow. Maybe the Dark Friends traveled to this world too. Plus, you know, they have the horn and the dagger, which is why we're on this journey in the first place. Let's chase them. So Rand says, "All right." So Huron jumps in the shadow.
Yeah, he jumps in the shadow.
Goes to check the trail. So Loyal says that the stones came from an older age than the Age of Legends. And even the Age of Legends, I said, I didn't really understand them. So how are we going to use one without the power, Rand? Taran just avoids the question, says, "We'll figure it out, man. Don't worry. Don't worry about it. I got it."
Taran's like, "Calm down. Everybody calm down. Just one second.
Just trying to think here.
Calm down." And then,
I was like, "Okay, all right." The land is washed out and seemed to twist the eye. Rand asks if Loyal's book said anything about this. Nope. Nothing to it but to do it then. So Hurin leads the way south. Rand says, "It looks like it's 3 or 4 days to the Artur Hawkwing Monument. Wonder if that exists in this world the way the stones do. If this is a world that could be, maybe it's still standing. So let's see some tourist trap sites while we're here." And south they ride. And side note, as I've mentioned before, I really want to know more about that age before the Age of Legends. Really do. That'd be fun. Just go back another 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years. Tell us a little bit more.
Yeah, back in that time, this monument to Artur Hawkwing was actually just a big statue of Carrot Top.
Yes, yes, those are the statues we need more of in every in every town, for sure. Chapter 14, Wolf Brother. A Lyda perspective chapter. I'm just kidding. Our boy Perrin with the doggos in his head.
What? Okay.
Tar is not pleased that Rand, Hurin, and Loyal are gone. Well, mainly that Hurin is gone because he's the sniffer.
Yeah, he kind of like care less about what happened to Rand and Loyal to a degree.
It, my sniffer who's going to find the horn that was going to bring glory to the borderlands. Not a goat kissing track, Uno says. Burn me, not so much as a flaming hoof scrape. It just bloody vanished. Ingtar wonders aloud why they would leave. Perrin doesn't know either. Then he realizes they don't have to give up the chase after all. He closes his eyes, lets his senses expand, senses wolves. Wolves ask if he is Longtooth, who's Elias. No, pictures himself, a young man with broad shoulders, curly hair, an axe at his belt, fighting white cloaks. Young Bull, they call him. Name given to him by the wolves. Yes. Perrin gives the smell of Rand, Loyal, and Hurin to the wolves. They smelled Rand when everyone rode into their campsite and haven't since. Perrin sends the scent of Fane and the Trollocs, and in the distance he hears a wolf pack howl. They hate Trollocs. Also fire. Yep. Fane's scent puts them in a frenzy. He asks them where, and they show him south. Also, they're going to go kill the Trollocs. Perrin feels the urge to join them, but stops, breaking contact. Thinks I'm a man, not a wolf. Matt asks, "You okay, buddy? I can make you some willow bark tea if you're sick." "I'm okay," Perrin says. He tells Ingtar he knows where the Dark Friends and the Shadowspawn went. Obvious question, how? And Perrin shockingly answers honestly, "The wolves told me." Ingtar says, "I've heard of this dude named Elias Machera. So those wolves will track the Shadowspawn for us? Good. I will have the horn no matter what it takes." But Ingtar says, "You should probably keep this between us for now. Some of the fellows might not understand, even though wolves are considered good luck in the borderlands." Perrin says, "Yeah, I didn't even really want to tell you." Ingtar says, "Let them think you're a sniffer like Hurin. Wrinkle your nose a few times and everyone will buy it." So everyone buys it. Massima goes so far as to spit, but Uno nods thoughtfully. Matt is having none of it, of course. "You're as crazy as Rand. I'm the only sane one left from Emmons Field." Perrin pulls up sharply when he gets an image of from the wolves of a pile of bodies, torn flesh, heads severed, Trollocs slaughtering people from the village. Someone is following them. It's Perrin. "Sent by Moraine," she says. "The village back there was nasty, wasn't it?" Then her absent nature vanishes and she asks where the heck Rand is. Ingtar grimaces, gone with Hurin and the Ogier. "It's okay, though. We have a new sniffer in Perrin here. A new sniffer right as you lose your old one. How provincial. Very odd." Ingtar offers to take her back to where the three vanished, but she says she will ride with them instead. Varen asks Ingtar to tell her everything Rand did. Matt mutters, "It's Rand she's after, not the horn." Perrin nods. "Whatever you've gotten, Rand, wherever you've gotten off to, Rand, you better stay there. It's safer than here." Yeah, right. Right. Chapter 15, Kinslayer. Back to Rand and the boys on the Dark Friend Trail. Hurin is focused on the trail. Loyal doesn't have much to say. Clearly freaked out by this turn of events. I mean, who wouldn't be? Not like they teleported to Candyland. Actually, that would be pretty freaky, too. That elf-looking dude with the candy cane looks downright satanic to me.
Yeah, Candyland's, like, weird. Is scary.
Yeah. Little button nose, those oversized glove hands. Right.
The chocolate creature thing.
Very not cool. So Rand feels dizzy, unless he forms a void, which makes him feel the taint. It looks like there has been a war here or something. The ground is burned in places, like in weird streaks. Even the stuff that isn't burned looks lifeless. The grass is devoid of color, and there's no sign of wildlife anywhere. The water is drinkable, but tastes flat and sterile. Rand thinks the clouds are in straight, unnatural lines. Y'all on the path of the beam, baby. When they stop, Loyal sings to a tree, but different from Ogier tree songs Rand has heard. When he is done, he has a long staff and says it as though the land was glad for a weapon to be made. Off they go again after the Dark Friends. Kieran says it's like he's remembering the trail rather than his using his smell powers. There are other instances of violence, and there's echoes of violence in this world from the other one. So while at watch, Rand thinks he hears Padon Fain say, "It's never over, Althor." He distracts himself by going through sword forms. A fog rolls in, and up walks our boy, Beazelmon. Rand thinks, "You've got to be dreaming, right?" Kinda. B says he's known every name Rand has used for ages, even before Kinslayer. Oh, can we hear a few? It was Chad, wasn't it? Chad of the morning. Let the Chad ride again on the winds of time. Keeper of the seven Chads. You know.
Have you seen the SNL Chad sketches with Pete Davidson?
I don't think so, no.
And he's just this monosyllabic guy who's in these super dramatic situations. And they're like, "Chad, your only hope." And he's like, "Okay."
Well, now I'm apt it. Now, since they start Chad, I should definitely check them out.
Yes, yes.
Oh,
there's a recent, the most recent one was with Elon Musk.
Aha. So I see. Gotcha.
Anyway, yeah, you got to go further back, though, to fully appreciate that one.
Ongoing joke, I see. Okay. Mm-hmm. Beelzebub says they're tied together, but Rand says the father of lies is a good name for you. Beelzebub looks at Hurin and Loyal. Mitchin's Egwene. He says the tower will try to use Rand. Yeah, big reveal there. He says this time the wheel will be broken no matter what. Serve the Dark One. Take your place at my side and we will rule the galaxy as father and son. Rand says never and falls down a McDonald's playground slide that is at the bottom of Cloud City for some reason that never made sense. No, he denies Beelzebub and denies his power. So B makes the fog catch on fire. Neat trick. Disappears along with his burning fog. And Rand decides he had to be dreaming. Oh, except, oh, wait. There is a Herod branded on his palm from his sword. On account of holding it in the burning fog, I guess. He wraps it and resolves to never channel again since Beelzebub and the Aes Sedai seem to want him to.
So, yeah, that's a good place to stop for now. But first, we're going to talk a couple of spoilers maybe from that section. So, Sam, you had noted some spoilery things.
So when Nynaeve and Egwene are sort of in travel training, Alviarin, Leandrin, Varin... All three, and Alana, of course, not a Dark Friend, but the three, yeah. the three Dark Friend Aes Sedai, the three, I guess, Black Aja, are stopped by just to literally interrogate Egwene and Nynaeve about the three Teverian, just like so openly. Love that. It's fun.
It is funny how often those three, especially, are around these. First few books. I think there's a scene, is it this book or the second book where Nynaeve gets tested?
This book. Yeah. That's Shirium.
Right.
does her novice or her accepted test. So
right.
Just real.
And,
just
yeah.
Everywhere.
And
everywhere
is
we
right
go.
There.
Everywhere yeah. we go. Freaking Black Aja.
So yeah, they're all kind of hovering around them, which kind of makes sense. I mean, if you have some really powerful potential right there, then they would all kind of hope that they could find a way to figure out, oh, how do we manipulate
yeah,
this?
Yeah, on this subject, this was another thing. I didn't write this down. I was thinking about this with Ingtar, and I think later he talks about how he becomes a Dark Friend, but I always wonder, like, for all these people who are like, you know, how do you get into that club that somebody just come up to you one day and be like, hey, you want to be a Dark Friend? It's just so like, where do you join that club? Like, just doesn't, we meet on Tuesdays, it's Taco Tuesdays, you know, bring your own snacks. I don't know.
I mean, you know, this is different because Dark Friends aren't like exactly victims, but I watched the HBO documentary on the Nixium cult, the one that Allison Mack was a part of.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Smallville. And they describe the process of how they got women involved in that. It was like a pyramid scheme. They forced to try to get other people involved to make it easier on them.
Yeah, right.
So they would have like people working under them that they could then order around. And I mean, it was all, of course, extremely messed up, but actually that's kind of the way you would expect like Dark Rings to act.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Makes sense.
Getting somebody involved. So I totally gross real world way. I could see that being kind of a similar sort kind of
like,
thing.
Like gangs and stuff, I guess, too, to some degree.
Like one of the big things in that is they talk about collateral, like to get in, they wouldn't even tell them what the true nature of it was, but they would say, you need to tell us something that would like ruin your life if people knew about it. And so if they didn't have anything, they would have to like make something up, have like a video of them saying something awful about a loved one or whatever, something like that, something that would hurt their relationship with somebody.
Right.
And anyway, and then they would hold that over them so that they would have to obey. Yeah, it's really messed up. Anyway, I'm probably going to cut most of that out.
Yeah, you're good. Yeah, no, that was interesting to me.
All right. Well, then, thanks for joining us. As always, we want to remind you that we love hearing from you guys. So please reach out to us on the socials at Podcast TSM and visit our website at tsmpodcast.com. Fill out our contact form or email us at stuff@tsmpodcast.com. And if you have questions, comments, corrections, whatever, we'll talk through those things at our next mailbag episode, which will probably be about a month from now. Don't forget, you can always support the podcast by going to our website, tsmpodcast.com, and clicking on that little donate button. You can donate reoccurring or just once by clicking on yearly, then clicking remind me, and it won't draft from your bank that way, and then like make a one-time donation. You'll be good. And we do appreciate that. But you know, if you're not able to or don't want to, that's fine. We're still glad you're here. So anyway, thanks guys so much for listening. It's awesome to have had you. And until next time, Tysharmanethrin.